Have either any of you ever been to Calais?
Oh, I have never been to France at all, but in preparation for this episode, I discovered that Calais has one of those like come visit scenic Calais type websites, and one of the standout features of Calais was that if you go up on the cliffs, you can see on a clear day the cliffs of Dover. So the best thing about Calais is you can see England.
I can see my house from here. Awesome. Yeah.
Nice. That's a great tourist motto. You can see cooler stuff.
Yep.
Here we are.
Welcome, broads, bastards, and all the swords in our armory to Swordboys Cut by Cut. I am Rick.
I'm Jonathan.
And I'm Robin.
And today we are joined by our special guest, Dan Marfield from Tombstone Titanic, a free podcast, all sorts of different things. Introduce yourself, Dan.
Hello. You probably know me as Duff. You can call me Duff. Rob and Joe will be mad if I don't point out that I wasn't on Tombstone.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he went on Tombstone. What are you talking about?
Well, I went on Tombstone, but I didn't do 120 minutes of it. No. Like, I didn't. That was one of the few things I didn't have my brain melted by doing a minute by minute.
That just tells me that Rick just got busted for not listening to Tombstone Minute. That's what.
Yeah.
What that?
I didn't listen to Tombstone Minute. I did not do my due diligence for the guests that we had on the show. So far, we are off to a flying start.
I think you should throw yourself off of a giant cliff.
Yeah.
So I'll bring up my research that's very, very thorough that I did.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a bit of a Dumas head, and very familiar with the story. And by that, I mean that in addition to watching this for the first time yesterday, I skimmed the Wikipedia of the book. And I rewatched the Wishbone episode of The Three Musketeers.
Thought maybe you're going to say you watched that. There's like a 2004 Donald,
there's a
Goofy
zillion
and
versions.
Mickey. There's a Mickey version of it. Like,
oh,
they did
yeah,
it,
yeah.
That people are really famous. By the way, I was trying to look up for this episode. I was trying to look up hidden Mickeys. Yeah, because, you know, it's a Disney film. There's usually hidden Mickeys in the movie. Can't find a damn thing because when I put in Mickey and Three Musketeers, all I get is that movie, and I can't get around the world. I can't. The internet will not allow me to learn if there's a hidden Mickey. I'm sure there's one. Everyone, let me know.
All right. Well, for everybody else that's watching this same version of Three Musketeers that we have been the last several weeks, we are in cut 5. It begins at 1 hour, 9 minutes, 15 seconds. It goes until 1 hour, 26 minutes, 7 seconds, beginning with the Countess de Winter's party boarding their boat in Calais and ending with the Musketeer Corps storming the castle to stop Richelieu.
Mm-hmm. This, I'm super happy with this cut. Yeah, because at first I was like, there's nothing in this cut except her dying. And
what are you
then
talking
like,
about? This is action packed.
I know it's action packed. I couldn't remember for some reason the scene in the in the courtyard completely like left my mind. Mm-hmm. For some reason I thought that was later in the movie, so it would be in like cut 6. But we get the whole thing. This thing's other than really boring prison talk, pretty good cut.
Yeah, this cut is arguably like a bridge from like cut 4 to cut 6. Like, we've got to resolve the spy storyline. We got to resolve what's going on with Athos and Milady, get back to Paris for like all the cool stuff. But I would argue that showing up at midnight to a ghost ship full of dead bodies is a pretty baller way to start a cut.
And we left with, we left with D'Artagnan being punched or kicked or whatever into unconsciousness. So that's where we pick up here.
I think it's really funny that when Milady steps out of her horse carriage thing, she's wearing spy regalia as if like everything around her isn't announcing, hey, this is Milady de Winter. She's here for her ship. But she steps out, she's like, I'm in disguise.
It's like in Assassin's Creed games where it's like, it won't let you do something. It's like, you have to be in disguise. And in disguise means putting on that cloak. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, now you're, you know, you're incognito now, even though you're wearing like this dark of night shroud or whatever.
Yeah. Milady is doing, she's searching for porn. So she's opened up her incognito cloak.
No one can get me now.
Yep.
I was really, and she does jump off, dive off something like in Assassin's Creed. She does dive face forward. Oh, yeah, she just doesn't land in a bale of hay. It's the only problem. Well, maybe there's a bale of hay down there. I don't know.
I mean, we don't see. I mean, she gets obscured by a cliff as she's falling, so she could be back for the planned sequel.
Right. Well, for the Man in the Iron Mask, yes, the sequel to the Three Musketeers.
She has escaped death a couple times before, so I mean. Sure.
Am I the only one who thinks this is just the back of the set of the Pirates of the Caribbean? Like they just went into the ride where you're not supposed to go, like where they like let like where technicians work, and it's like, we can just have a thing like go up against the boat. Sure, this will be fine.
I don't. Yeah. So I'm not a huge fan of any of the Pirates of the Caribbean movies, and this captures the theme park feel better than any of those ever did.
Well, like they always, because you have to have the smoke, because the smoke in the Pirates of the Caribbean ride is so you know don't notice you're in a giant building.
Yeah, that you're just in a warehouse in Florida.
Yeah, in Florida
or California. Also, like all the guys on the ship, like look like they're just animatronic wax dummies. Like they just have great facial expressions and that kind of goofy, like. Campy Walt Disney way.
I like that Henri is some sort of boat pirate or some sort of boat vampire and must announce himself and ask to be allowed on the boat. It's like a weird, you know, the formality of boat etiquette. I don't really know this. I've never actually yelled this before I jumped on a boat. I should from now on.
It's so rude when you just waltz onto somebody's boat without asking for permission.
Yeah, I love this. You could hear that's Aramis, right? That gives him
permission. Granted.
Very mockingly.
I mean, this is of all of the Oliver Platt cuts, this is the peak Oliver Platt-ness. This cut is adorable. I love him. You don't love him after this cut. I don't know what to say. He's hilarious. Yeah,
he's charming. He's the best actor of the three and the fourth. D'Artagnan.
Yes.
You know what? We used to be a proper country where guys who look like Oliver Platt could be like action hero leading men. Like, like he looks like a bridge troll and he's like a leading man.
We're getting back there. We're moving back there. I think we're getting away from super ripped, except in superhero movies. I think we're getting to a point. Go look at, for all you football fans, go look at the physicality of Patrick Mahomes, one of the best quarterbacks ever. He looks like Oliver Platt's body. Like when you see his body, you're like, oh, he doesn't really like he's fit, but he's not.
Yeah.
He's not cut like fucking D'Artagnan is.
Yeah. Or like, you know, like kind of like a lot of 80s pro wrestlers were dudes who like used to be really ripped and then just kind of stopped lifting weights and they have like a coating of fat over it now. Like, like Ted DiBiase, like those dudes. Bring those dudes back.
Bring back dad bod is what you're saying. Yep.
Yeah. Yes.
More like Platt bod.
Oh yeah, I want to be Platt bod.
Platt bod.
So yeah, they go on the boat and
it's midnight. It is literally midnight. And Henry is shouting at the top of his lungs. You can hear it echoing down the street.
It's Henri. It's French.
Whatever. She calls him Henry.
People are trying to sleep. She's not doing the
accent. Remember the accents are implied in this movie. Everyone's accent is implied.
Oh, so this is almost like a Babelfish thing. Like she's saying Henry, but we should be hearing Henri.
Yeah.
She's saying Hank. Where's Hank?
But all of these sailors, they look like Pirates of the Caribbean extras because they are all dead.
So they murdered.
How many people have they murdered in this movie?
Everyone.
They murdered the entire crew of a boat. That's not cool.
There's a murder house tavern they left.
Yeah.
Also, it's like very cleanly done. There's no blood. Like they don't notice they're murdered until they're right up next to them. So it was all clean cuts.
Yeah. This scene, I believe, inspired a scene in a later Kevin Costner movie, because in 1995, Dennis Hopper would do this very same thing in Waterworld. Kill everybody the floating platform and string them up as if they were still alive.
It's the future, so Dennis Hopper could have seen the Three Musketeers
exactly
before the water rose.
I thought you were going to imply that they were all going to play baseball like they're ghosts.
What?
Different Costner movie. Sorry.
Listen, if I'm not mentioning Costner at all over the course of this movie, what good am I doing?
How much? So it's midnight. How long did it take, number one, to kill all these dudes without the others noticing and then prop them up in a way that's realistic?
You just see Porthos just like, no, let's have him lean up against this. He's having to drag people's carcasses around.
Like, it's like a department store window display where it's like, nope, make the mannequin angle this way, except with 200-pound smelly pirates that you just killed.
Gosh, it's not exactly a heroic move.
No,
to murder people in secret and string them up,
their corpses. There's a lot of.
It's baller, but yeah, it's like there's a lot of stuff where also are we supposed to look up to Platthos because he was a
Porthos? Platthos.
I had to do mnemonics. I'm like, all right, Porthos, Platt, both start with P, so I just Platthos. Are we supposed to think he's heroic that he was a pirate?
I
think it's just that he had a life before this. Aramis had a life before this.
Athos, but if you're a kid's movie, it's a PG Disney movie, you watch it, and the implication is kind of being a pirate's being a firefighter or something.
Yeah.
Listen,
he's a first plunderer. He's a first plunderer. He gets there early.
Yeah.
They're all heroes.
Like pirates stormed into the Twin Towers when it was falling to save people or something.
Listen, as far as Disney is concerned,
a little bit something like this.
Pirates are always cool in Disney's book.
Oh, they're always cool and awesome. It's just they've kind of over the years, they've become kind of goofy and childlike, and in real life it's they were murderers and rapists who just sailed the seas.
Yeah,
they're a little shy on murdering on camera, because as soon as they're fighting Milady's men just get tossed in the water it's A-team time,
being thrown into 3 feet of water somehow nullifies them as a threat.
Well, as soon as they go into the water, Disney security has to come and drag them out so they can be ejected from Disney World.
I wouldn't want to be in that water. There's just a bunch of pennies and quarters.
Being thrown into that Pirate of the Caribbean water, that's punishment enough.
Oh, man. They've all got staph infections now, so.
Yeah. Anybody who was drinking the Splash Mountain water before they shut it down for the refurb, those people definitely have some sort of cancer now.
Yeah, they have a prion disease in their brain. It's just,
I'm just really glad.
Do distemper.
I'm just really glad that they don't accidentally capture all the people sitting there and eating at the Blue Bayou, which is the restaurant right next to the Pirates of the Caribbean, right in Disneyland. People are there trying to eat their beignets and they got all these guys splashing the water on them.
Were accurate, at least in Disney World, everyone have those delicious Dole smoothie things outside.
I don't think that's everywhere in Disney World.
It's in Adventureland, which is all the old timey shit is.
Yeah.
And I just remember it's Pirates and Jungle Cruise, and then they have the Dole fruit stand thing, and you get a delicious Dole smoothie or whatever it is.
Yeah, when I was in Disneyland last time, the Dole Whip was over by the Enchanted Tiki Room, over on the other side of Jungle Cruise.
Okay.
From
Are
Pirates,
you talking Disneyland or Disney World?
Oh, I'm talking land, because I have more experience with land.
It's roughly the same as World. I think
it's by itself. It's near the Tiki Room, though. Because the Jungle Cruise and that shitty Swiss Family Robinson tree are all over on that side.
Oh, come on. They refurbished that.
I think that's an island in Disney World. I'm not positive, though.
But the Adventureland, like the more Frontierland, one its own thing, and then Adventureland, you have to walk through, you have to get through Frontierland. You can come around. You can actually get to any
Yeah,
of them,
Frontierland is just like the country bears and like
which
the
is gone. Yeah, they shut
what?
down Country
Countrybears.
Country Bear Jamboree. Much to my wife's, thank God. My wife's like, thank God. She hated that fucking thing, and it used to make me laugh so hard when she'd be in there, and she'd be so mad because she can like hear the clicking of the eyeballs, and she's just so mad at how old it is. She's like, I hate this. I hate this whole thing.
Yeah.
Oh, that's too bad.
It is.
I
Well, I
mean,
think it reminds her too much of her husband because I'm basically a country bear.
it is. All the bears are in shorts.
Yeah, just in shorts, working from home.
Talking about rat holes. Gosh. Hey, Disney, if you're listening, this is prime advertising we're giving you right now.
Yeah.
Give us a little bit of a kickback. Like, I'll take park passes. Come on.
Yeah, we can be Disney sword boys.
Oh yeah, I'll work for anybody. I don't care. I'm a whore for anything
Yeah.
free.
Listen.
If the dune, if the dune sex bucket wants to promote us, if we just be the dune sex bucket show, it has no swords in it, but I'll still talk about it. I don't care.
Worm boys.
Worm boy, bucket boys. All we do is talk about the promotional buckets for movies.
I put my sword in that bucket.
Oh yeah.
So,
So yeah.
yeah, Sabine is
Who?
escaping, running away from
Who?
all of
Who's
the.
Sabine?
Rebecca De Hornay.
Yeah, she's running away from all of the awesome stuff happening on the boat,
Yeah.
because not only do the henchmen just get thrown overboard or throw themselves overboard, but we get a great callback to Raiders of the Lost Ark with Parker doing
Oh,
his
God.
katas, and then Porthos just opening up the trap door. I do love the little bit of mocking that Porthos gets to do of Parker before he dispatches him.
And let's all give him props as an actor for not doing a pigeon style face and or voice. Like he just does, and then just
Like
cuts it. Easily could have
my
been something bad.
like I was like a cat. Like I was like puffed up, like, oh boy, we're gonna get
Here we
racist now. It's
go.
like
Nope.
I was ready to find out like he's actually like a martial arts master or something, or
No.
like like Jonathan said, like he starts doing like the Ching Chong voice or something,
Yeah. Yeah. But
but
he
great,
didn't eat a true actor.
yeah, but mercifully we just have a Raiders of the Lost Ark bit. It went as well as it could.
So I assume Parker is dead because he fell into a thing of knives. Like what? Do we assume everyone's dead
It's
that
like
fell in the
the
water?
it's like an Austin Powers where it's like, ow, I'm still alive down
Yeah.
here. Like he fell, he probably broke an ankle or something, but it's like what 4 or 5 feet? Like he's likely
I mean,
alive.
Rick,
The
I know
man's
you
only
love
what,
editing
3.5 feet
3½ feet tall?
Rick, I know you love editing things. Can you edit? There's going to be two different times you're going to have to edit it. Where one, where Parker falls in the hole and he's not really dead. He's like, I'm not dead. And then also later on when Sabine falls off the thing and they're all looking like, oh, God be with her. And then she's like, I'm not dead. I'm actually alive.
Yeah, I definitely need to edit Sabine jumping off the cliff with the goofy yell.
Yoo-hoo-wee! That'd be
Is there
good.
a Wilhelm scream in this movie? It seems like there should be one.
When the Frenchman falls off the top of the parapet, I listened for it, but it was just a normal scream.
I mean, there's like 1,000 times it could be in this movie, which is
Maybe
why
it's
I didn't.
Babblefish again, and he screams in French, and I'm supposed to assume it's a Wilhelm scream.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wilhelm. Wilhelm.
Yeah. But anyway, getting back to Milady, who I guess is named Sabine because she has a
Yeah.
rotten run of luck. Not only does she run into her ex as she's trying to escape, but she's also running into, I guess, her ex-brother-in-law at the same time.
Patchy.
Yeah.
It's still your brother-in-law if you killed the brother.
Is that
I'm
how it
pretty
works?
sure. I
I've
think
never
so.
killed a spouse, so I wouldn't know.
For legal purposes, he's saying he doesn't know.
I don't know. I love that Athos shows up with not a scratch on him.
Right.
It's
With
like
a new
I...
horse. His old horse has been murdered, so
Oh
he
yeah,
got
his
himself a new
old
horse.
horse named Whitey Axelrod. He has a new horse.
Yeah. But also, yeah, he calls her Sabine, which like he's been watching too much Star Wars Rebels and got it confused. And she calls him Athos, which is his musketeer name, not his the name he had when he was married to her. So right. Why is she calling him Athos?
Oh, does she? Do you not think his name was Athos? Why wasn't his name Athos? No, he didn't take a new name.
Changed his name to Athos.
No, he said he just gave up. I thought he just gave up his title, not like his title, like his name, like. But he gave up the Duke of Schmungington or whatever.
If you give Athos up a title, you're giving up your name. Like Athos, how did Wikipedia describe it? It's a nom de guerre, basically a war name.
Oh, okay.
Is it like how all the kings would choose a name that wasn't theirs?
Right.
Yeah.
By the way,
Athos is his musketeer name.
So,
right.
One thing that I don't really care, but like it bugs me is like somehow Sabine is snuck up on, even though Athos would have seen this dude coming like 50 feet away. Like if you the shot composition, like they're out in public and like behind her is just like a dock and all of a sudden it's like, oh, he's here.
Off to Milady's, I guess, right from where she's looking. There's a couple of barrels with some bags on it. Count de Winter is crouched down there.
Again, he's activated Assassin's Creed stealth rules. Mode. And like, he's crouching. We can't see him now.
He's off to her maleft. And he jumps out like, oh, now's the time I'll do it.
Yeah.
By the way, he has the weirdestly low voice for. He looks like a little skinny dude.
The whole time I'm like, he sounds like Harvey Fierstein.
I will not be so kind.
David, Lady Melinda.
Yeah. I've got to find the three musketeers.
Adding this extra guy to this plot, I think is confusing. They should have cut all this and made it.
There had to be a reason why she died, because the musketeers, I don't think, would have had her murdered.
Right.
Not that she needed to be murdered in the movie. Like, I don't know if
they would have forgiven her because they're honorable men. And that's right. What happens in these type of things.
Instead, the new Count de Winter, whatever his name is, Count de Money, puts her in like a DIY. I guess you can just look. I had to bring her to a prison, but I have to be the one that watches her. It's like a Uber for prison.
Exactly.
Like,
yeah.
You go to Calais and you have to call somebody. Like, where's the closest? Who's got the closest jail? But we have no guards.
And it's like an underground catacomb prison.
Mm-hmm. It's an AirBnP. It's a bed in prison.
Yeah, and the way this plays out, it's like we have this confrontation between Athos and Sabine, and a big reunion, and then cut to these guys talking about the document. You know who I got to talk to? The girl I was just talking to. Next scene. Oh my gosh.
I know someone who can help.
Smush this together.
So
I feel like there's something missing. I feel like there was a scene that they shot that is missing from the middle of this.
Look, you know, in the editing room, they were just thinking, look, the kids are getting bored. Her boobs aren't out. So let's just trim this down.
Well, they give her the eye light. They give her that nice cute. They give her the Morticia Adams light.
This movie was way hornier than I was expecting.
It is. Well, because it's French, because everyone's boobs are out.
Right.
Yeah.
Tim Curry is just 95% of this.
What's inside those robes? He's got the moon. He's got the sun inside those folds of his robe. Let's show me your sun. Yeah.
Any movie that Tim Curry is in instantly becomes hornier.
Yeah, that's true.
It was one of the most confusing parts of Muppet Treasure Island. It's how horny that movie was.
And the shadow.
Yeah.
I didn't expect that.
Like or Congo.
Yeah.
Everyone was going ape in that one. Anyway. They've recovered the treaty from Milady and they are unrolling it for the audience to see. I tried pointing Google Lens at this thing and it had a bad time. I'm pretty sure
you broke Google's brain.
Yeah, I think the app just had a conniption. It did not go well. Like, what did it offer?
Is it in French? I didn't really look at it that hard. Is it actually French?
This is actually written in French. You can make out some of the words. I mean, it's written in the scripty, old timey type of writing.
Papyrus?
I assume it just says "Voulez-vous coucher avec moi."
Yeah, it's
from Tim Curry to Tim Curry.
It's Comic Sans. From what I can make out. It says, Monsieur, je vous dépêche de something or other, occupé pour vous, Henriel D. So it's, sir, I would,
just
I don't know, like,
Evil Dead just now.
Ask your discretion in opening up a dialogue about
that
the
too,
attack of something on the coast of Burgundy. I think it's a...
Well, this is riveting.
Yeah, it's not... You know, this is the situation that boomers that are always comparing about. I, as a millennial, do not know how to read old-timey cursive. Therefore, I am doomed to never
Especially
understand old documents
French.
Like the Constitution.
So what I like is that at the AirBnP, not only do you get a cell, but they'll also, if for a certain price, will lend you out a executioner de jour. That's French.
He's he's a freelance gig economy executioner.
Yeah.
Maybe I missed it and there's a good explanation, but like, why don't they care about the Musketeers anymore? Like, he just shows up to the jail where Patchy had the Rebecca de Hornay throne. Like, shouldn't he want to kill Athos? Shouldn't he want to?
Why?
I don't know.
He didn't have anything to do with the murder of De Winter.
It seems just like the Musketeers are a big problem and then they don't care about them for a little while.
Musketeers are only a problem to Richelieu. Nobody else cares about the Musketeers being disbanded. Like, despite being disbanded, like, the Musketeers are still in and of themselves, like, wealthy men who are well-trained in war. So...
Yeah, aren't they kind of just Pinkertons? Like, yes. They're just kind of a private army for rich people.
They're Pinkertons who fuck.
Yep.
they're just running around winching.
Yeah, being horny. Oh, man. Well, did a generation learn how to wench and I missed out on it because I didn't see this when I was young?
Yep. You don't know how to woo a woman with both sweet words and kick-ass dance moves.
Like, this movie taught 10-year-olds how to sling game.
Mm-hmm. True. I mean, look who Athos was able to pull down.
Yeah.
Now, Kiefer Sutherland's a very handsome man, but he's not Rebecca de Mornay. I think she's out of his league. Yeah,
We got hotties in this movie. We got young Julie Delpy.
Yep. I got a question for you. Who's hotter, Lost Boys Kiefer Sutherland or Rebecca de Mornay? Is it a tie?
I mean, I'm always going to go with Rebecca de Mornay because I saw The Hand That Rocks the Cradle far earlier than I should have, and it probably did things to me.
Yeah, I saw Risky Business at a very young age also.
Yeah, Risky Business is what did it for me.
But Kiefer Sutherland was in Lost Boys, and he was very attractive.
He was? I think he's very attractive here.
Okay.
I'm just saying.
He's rugged. He's a good-looking dude.
He is a good-looking dude. So there, she's going to die.
He's no Donald.
He's no Donald. No. I don't think Donald Sutherland was ever a good-looking man. I think Donald Sutherland was like a duck with pants on. He just a weird-looking dude.
You just think they're the same person?
Yeah, kind of. They're gonna kill her. They're gonna cut her head off.
They're gonna kill that poor woman.
She's gonna take her secrets to the grave because Athos did not think to say please when he was interrogating her in the cell.
Yes. Couldn't they do this closer to the boat?
I was just gonna say, why did they have to go to Luke Skywalker's island to kill her?
So according to that Calais tourism website that I mentioned earlier, I don't know if I cut that out. It might actually not be in the episode. But anyway, the Calais tourism website says that these cliffs are 10 kilometers west of Calais. They are the 134-meter high Cap Blanc Nez, France's most northerly cliff.
They actually shot this in France?
I don't think so. This is probably... No.
This is Rump's Point again. We're right where they picked up... she found the unconscious Chris O'Donnell earlier. Gotcha. Just shot the scene after that.
Okay.
But they've got a couple of statues over here on the edge. This must be where they regularly execute people. Why else would they have, you know, a recreation of, what is it, cavalry? Golgotha? Whatever the hill was that Jesus died on?
Yeah, Golgotha.
Yeah, and this, and like, you know, this executioner, like, he's one of those animals in the Flintstones where, like, it's a living. Like, he could not give a shit about any of this. He's like, whatever. I'm paid to kill someone. I'm going to kill someone.
I get
he
paid
just,
by the head.
Yeah. This is just a Wednesday for him.
Sorry, I did the wrong accent. I get paid by the head.
I thought this guy was Pat Roach.
He's got the mustache for it.
Yeah.
Is George Lane Cooper. He is apparently 6'11".
Wow.
Excuse me?
Yeah, that's what it says in his IMDb.
Jeez.
He's a stuntman in Superman's 1 and 2, as well as 3 Bond movies, Diamonds, Moonraker, Octopussy. He was in Crawl, Brazil, The Mummy.
It's like Richard Kiel height. That's wow. Yeah.
But, so he's going to kill her, and instead he's stopped by Athos stops it.
Athos has got to make it all about him.
Yeah, what an asshole. He's like, forgive me. Forgive you. I'm about to die.
This is Milady's big time. This is her big execution. Then Athos is like, hold on. I need to stop everything and make it all about
me. This is like trying to marry somebody at a basketball game. Like, fuck off.
The crowd's out there, boo, say no.
At first, it seemed like they were going to let her go. The line was, we forgive you for your crimes. And it's just like, oh? And then he's like, go. Die in peace. Oh.
Yeah. And once again, like, the executioner could not give a shit. He's like, whatever, I'm getting paid either way.
Yeah. Hey, he looks at the new count and the winner's like, I'm getting fucking paid. No, it doesn't matter that I didn't do it. If she jumps off, that's fine.
Gosh. Okay. Funny enough, this
you better
is not,
leave 5 stars for me too.
This is not the first time that audiences in 1993 would have watched someone Peter Pan themselves off of something that is high, because this movie came out in November, and Last just Mohicans? A few months earlier in August, that's when The Fugitive came out.
Yeah. Oh, what about Last of the Mohican? That's a famous jumping off a cliff.
I think that was a year earlier too.
For love.
For love. I don't think The Fugitive was for love.
No, The Fugitive is not for love.
This is a first, though, for Disney. This is the first character in a Disney movie to commit suicide.
Yeah, it's
IMDb.
They would never produce something like this now, because Disney's become so like neutered, unless it's just like generic baddies. But like, you'd never have an actual main character like this. Like, I was like, wow, she just did that, huh?
All right, this is where I need
well,
to
she's not
start
dead.
Doing
we don't
crossovers.
Know that she's dead.
I think that Athos stopped Milady from being beheaded because Milady is actually an immortal. And he knew that if she got her head cut off, there'd be lightning and explosions, and the immortal's secret would be revealed to, you know, everybody. And so he stopped it and allowed her to throw herself off the cliff, because immortals cannot die from blunt force trauma. Landing at the bottom of a cliff, the Highlander
or
TV
an elevator
show.
Shaft.
I think she doesn't know. I don't think she knows there's a cliff behind her. I think she was trying to get away.
She's like, I'm right here, Normie.
I'll dive into the ocean. That'll save me. Oh, wait, there's no ocean there. It's just more cliff.
Just jagged rocks.
So on her way down, do you think she hit stuff? Do you think she like Mola Rum, like hit the side as she went down?
Yeah, she probably nicked herself and bounced off stuff.
Oof. Oof. I don't know if that's better or worse way to go than having your head chopped off. Because I looked up head chopping off, and French.
those words exactly.
Was it the
head
Reddit?
Chopping off.
Was it r/heads chopping off?
It was. I was such a horny. It was such a horny thread. I did not think it was this horny. So I go in there, and the French are famous for heads chopping off. And they didn't start doing guillotine until the 1700s, until the French Revolution.
I want the baby's head off.
Especially for and guillotine at the time was only for the nobility. They didn't do it. Regulars, normals, got like horrible ways, like mostly hanged. Few people had their heads cut off with swords. And I'm like, I've seen Game of Thrones. I know that like if you don't have a sword that's like made of Valyrian steel, like cutting through someone's neck is not the easiest process, and you might not get it the first time you do it. Like movies have taught us, if you get a sword anywhere near anybody's neck, your head just falls off.
Right.
Yeah. But in reality, it's like the core of your entire body is there. Like that, the hardest, you know, your
blood's going to spurt up everywhere, and then it's going to be embedded, and you have to like put your boot on their back to pull out the axe.
And they're still alive because they're choking on their own blood.
Yeah.
But they're alive because their spinal cord's still together, and it's like loppy neck. They're like hanging off the side.
You know, the guillotine. It was the old saying. you know, it's necessity. It's the mother of invention.
Yes.
So like, look, it's too hard to behead people. Let's have gravity do the work.
Listen, letting gravity decide the final outcome of things is Disney's bread and butter.
Well, if only this could have happened, you know, after the penal code of 1791 in France, which enacted that they abolished capital punishment for, I'm gonna name some things. Let me know. Raise your hand if this affects you. Bestiality, blasphemy, heresy, pederasty.
All right, I'm fine with that one.
Okay. Sacrilege, sodomy, and witchcraft. So they put boinking kids and witchcraft, one real, one made up, in the same, they lumped it together.
Yeah.
I think I got a bingo there.
Yeah? Did you get a cross?
Yeah. Listen, heresy and blasphemy, those are two wildly broad definitions of crimes.
They're also,
I mean, if I'm going to get killed for heresy, there's going to be some sodomy. Let's just say I'm going down for one thing. I'm going down for, well, maybe not all of them, but I'm going down for five of the six.
I was worried where you were going with that.
I'm not going for pederasty. But witchcraft and bestiality, maybe. Who knows?
Listen, if you break into a church and steal their religious artifact and hide it in your prison wallet as you're making your escape and do some sort of ooga booga hand waves, you're going to get three different charges right there.
If you put your penis in the holy water, you're automatically murdered. They don't like that.
Oh, that doesn't heal your syphilis?
Isn't your dick holy then? Like,
yes. Well, it is, but they're mad at you. It doesn't matter. What... So anyway, she's dead.
Sure. She's either dead or she is at the bottom of this cliff slowly using her immortal powers to heal up and then go on and, you know, fight Connor McCloud
someday. It might be like Midsummer where someone needs to come finish her off with a big rock.
She may not be mostly dead. She may just be partially dead.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. She may have just shattered her legs.
I see a lot of crosses around. This might be holy ground. So this might be against other rules as well.
I love the next shot. Where they
she might have just fallen onto a pit of bodies. Maybe this is like a just like a popular spot.
Okay, Rick. So when she falls, you need not only have her like, I'm not dead, but at least like have like when she hits something, she's like, like she kind of like is rolling down a mountain and then lands on someone else. Someone's like, what the hell?
Maybe just like a big splorch sound effect. I don't know.
Like pots falling downstairs. The biggest racket you could make. There's so many different versions. I love this next scene. This next scene with the sniper and snapper, as French would say.
Snapper.
The snapper. And
how bold of these guys to just like, yeah, we'll just do a mock assassination for. Yeah, there's a big picture of the king. We're pretending.
What's going on in the main area right now? Cardinal Richelieu is having his playtime. Just leave him alone. You can't go out there.
This is not the royal courtyard. This is some random courtyard somewhere else.
It's like it's all busted up because as they walk back, like, I mean, obviously it's a French or whatever. It's an Austrian castle from a million years ago. So it looks like shit. Like when they're walking back talking about it, you can see the sides of the walls have like water damage and stuff. So it's supposed to be like in another part of, like, I'm sure there's just, this is the gun part. This is where we shoot the muskets.
They just went to the open market square to plot their cloak and dagger assassination.
Yes.
With the 7 foot tall portrait of the king.
Yeah. Right.
By the way, who painted the king? They gave him, they did a really good job of not painting the weasel faced king that we've all seen in this movie.
He's got better hair in that portrait too.
And not a giant schnoz like the actual
and guy. That's what happens. Like all these people are just inbred chuds and then their official portrait, you know, makes them look like, you know, like Errol Flynn or something. And that's why we
paint a chin on him, put a chin on him. Cause they don't normally have those.
It's like, can you, like, there's always like a royal aide next to the painter. Like, can you make it so he's not cross-eyed? And like, it's like his mouth doesn't close. Can you make it closed in the photo?
I know that the king is sucking his thumb, but can we not have his thumb in his mouth in this photo?
I was wondering what Richelieu meant by, like, talking about the painter, I think, saying he was always a little too flattering. So maybe I'm assuming that he's talking about how good he's making the king look in that portrait.
Yeah.
And I love the thing about, you know, does he have any qualms? No, he believes in God, honoring God above man. He's like, oh, a man of faith, I reassure you. Does the little, like, the most flippant,
I know,
God so be with funny. You, it's so good.
Yeah, whatever.
There's one reassuring thing, it's a religious sniper.
Yeah, it's like, oh, he's a fundamentalist? Oh, I trust those guys, they're good.
Yeah, they never turn on power.
Yeah, it's like, oh... he's a Mujahideen? Yeah, let's give him a bunch of weapons.
It was weird that he stood up and raised a knife and said, long live the fighters. That was weird.
You'd think that Crapton Rochefort would actually be a good sniper because he's already ready. Like, he's already, like, you'd think he'd be really good at it.
Well, his problem is range finding.
Oh. And his problem is he shoots with this eye. That's the that's his shooting eye.
He lost his good eye.
I appreciate it.
Yeah, so this movie taught me stronger? That they had sniper muskets.
Yeah. So rifling, which is something that is, you know, the lines inside the barrel that give the bullet a little bit of a spin. Rifling is not something that was normally done in muskets because muskets were mass produced and whatnot. Rifling is something that you find in specialized sport shooters and wealthy recreational hunters because of the manufacturing involved. But rifling was something that existed as early as the 16th century.
They said that a musket of the 16th century was accurate enough to hit a target of 20 inches from a distance of 100 meters. That's not bad. I mean,
that's better than a head.
That's a couple of football fields away.
Sure. 330 feet. So, and he's not 330 feet. He's like 100 feet, maybe. I feel like maybe it's 150 feet.
That courtyard can't be that big.
Yeah, so
he also has the high ground. He has the Obi-Wan advantage.
Yep.
He gets to roll advantage on his ranged attack because he has elevated location.
And we'll get to it in a second, but he also has, you notice he has more than one shot already set up, like in front of him. Mm-hmm. Like he's a professional. He's like, if I don't hit him, if I wing him, I'm gonna reload and fuck this guy up.
Yeah, 3 minutes later.
Yeah.
As I'm slowly jamming this into my gun. You'd think he'd bring three guns. I would just bring three guns and just have them loaded and ready to go.
Yeah. Movies have taught me that the real pros have that blanket they take out and they have multiple guns.
Yeah.
Yeah. That blanket. The gun blanket.
It's always a blanket. Like, dudes out, like, assassins always, they always, like, take out a blanket and unroll it and there's their arsenal.
Or they have a case. Or they have an actual, like, you know, case with all the stuff in it.
Yeah. And that's usually like mafia guys will have the case. Yeah.
So now it's the ride back from Calais, which I did the math. Awkward. Calais, we did this before, is 294 miles. We knew this originally. Well, they now have to go back. And a normal horse takes a horse that is trained. These are trained horses, I assume. They can ride up to 100 miles a day. That's pushing it, though.
Yeah.
Across fucked up 16th century roads, you know. It's not like he's
cobblestone and whatnot.
Yeah, and just, you know, fucking woods. So I assume, you know, he says he's going to be killed on Friday. I don't know what day it is. So I just assume they make it there just in time.
I think this all started on a Monday.
Did it?
Go back in our cuts.
I remember we talked about it. Now I don't remember.
I was like, how are they going to pull this off?
The ship sailed, I think, Wednesday at midnight or Tuesday at midnight. Hold on. Let me look this up. Have the stenographer roll back. The Persephone sails at midnight on Tuesday.
Okay, so he has 4 days to get back.
Yeah.
All right. Well, but they wasted half a day on the goddamn murdering of Sabine.
Yeah, Milady dies on a Wednesday, so they spend all day, all the rest of the day Wednesday, all day Thursday to arrive before the party on Friday.
I don't think
when I initially brought up the whole time thing, I was trying to factor in how the hell Milady was supposed to sail to France, or not France, to England, to talk to Lindsay Buckingham, and then come on back. To France, and then the whole horse ride from Calais to Paris. It's like,
I don't think that was ever part of it. I think he was going to be murdered, whether or not not in real time. I think the letter being given to the whatever
Lindsay the Buckingham.
Lindsay Buckingham was going to. It didn't matter when it got there because, you know, this is old times. It doesn't fucking matter. They would have found out about the murder after he got the letter, but maybe not before he was able to respond.
Yeah.
And the I don't think it mattered when the letter got there.
The murder would be like, oh, here I am, Duke of Buckingham. I've heard of this murder. I now see the Cardinal's power. Sign the treaty. Send it back.
I'm just wondering how they had time to write all those all for one and one for all things. And those little notes and put them on those crossbow bolts.
Do you think they have a stamp? Do you have a big rubber stamp?
That's what I assume.
Also, yeah. These notes also, what information are they delivering? I mean, the effect is the Musketeers now unearth all the swords and tunics they didn't burn. A giant file.
So you kept backup tunics of everything?
Yeah.
Maybe you guys were corrupt. You weren't supposed to have extras of your tunics and your swords.
Jonathan,
essentially, they just put out their motto. It's like they just put live, laugh, love on a tree or something. Like, yeah, there's no direction. There's no time about, oh, we're meeting up at this something or other.
Henri, what was in the arrow? It says it's 1 o'clock somewhere. I don't know. Go get the swords, I guess.
Did they forget to put the QR code where the invite was?
It's on the back. It's on the back.
That's what I'm assuming. There are definitely a few rogue musketeers that are like, well, it doesn't say any specific day. I mean, we'll go to Paris, but we don't have to be quick about it. They'll show up on Saturday or Sunday and everything will be over and be like, oh,
these guys are riding their ass off trying to get there. Should we hurry? Should we also hurry?
Is this something we need to be concerned about?
Where's your favorite place that you would hide something like this? I enjoy the giant barrel. I'm a fan of the wine barrel.
Your saber.
You're saying in like movie world or like I thought you meant like real life.
Okay, okay. Real life is so pedantic and boring because it's like underneath the couch. You know, it's like not cool. Like, what would be a fun, cool place in a movie? Like movie logic. Where's a cool place you would want to hide something?
I mean, the hidden bookcase. You pull the book and it turns, and there's a whole thing of swords just sitting there with your tunic right in the middle.
Oh, you go down to the musketeer cave. You open it up, and there's two poles, and you go down with your ward, pedantry. Your pedantry. You haven't begun.
You tried this pedantry.
It hasn't been made illegal yet. You don't. It's not illegal to do pedantry at this point. So,
no. What you need is one of those headboards that the gun safe people make, where you just press up on the headboard and the sword just drops down into your hand.
That seems like technically like a way to get stabbed.
Yeah, this happens in your bed.
Oh yeah, the headboard itself has a hinge that's spring loaded, so you just press on the headboard and the sword just slides down, and you just grab it, and then you've got it ready to go. It's designed for shotguns. The idea is you hide your shotgun in the headboard, and then you press on the headboard. It falls down into your hands, and then you can shoot your home invader from bed.
Yeah, this is what like preppers do. Because you know they don't want to sleep with your gun because you like suddenly put it off, but you want it at the ready.
Yeah. I assume that they had a bunch of wagons just full of swords, and they're just going through towns throwing swords out like Mardi Gras. Just whoever catches one is a musketeer. You're automatically a musketeer if you can catch the sword and not like catch the sword.
Yeah,
I had a weird thought.
Is it about the pedantry?
No, I just was suddenly like thinking, like, okay, Charlie was shooting this right around the same time he was shooting Hot Shots Part 2. Mm-hmm. Like, did he come back from filming in Three Musketeers? And he's like, I don't know, guys. Part 2 does not sound good enough. Part 2. Like, I just came back from this whole French thing. Anyway, Part 2. Let's do that.
I don't know if he has the power over people like that, but
be nice. I don't think he remembers anything about a 20-year period.
No, he's all high on crank right now. He doesn't know what's going on.
That tiger blood pumping through his veins. Just no time for memory, only time for action.
The next scene makes me laugh because what the fuck did they dress the king up in? What is he wearing?
Okay.
What?
He's a little dandy.
Before we talk about what the king is wearing,
it's the worst thing I've ever seen.
Can we please talk about how cloaks and hoods are the baseball and sunglasses of the 1620s?
Well, it worked for De Winter. It worked for Milady De Winter, so it works for them.
Is Athos wearing his dead ex-wife's cloak?
I hope so. You're not going to need this anymore, by the way.
Yeah.
Is this a
skinny? Don't let a good cloak go to waste.
Skinny. Is that the sizes back then? What is that? That's a skinny.
Skinny, slim,
tapered,
husky.
Yeah. Athletic.
I love that everyone is in black cloaks except for the one dude that escaped execution yesterday.
Yeah.
Guy with the feathery hair. No big deal.
Yeah. They're not putting a cloak over that. Freaking afro, that thing is amazing.
D'Artagnan is told to search the perimeter while the other three try to find the king, and D'Artagnan has a quick but, and then he's cut off by Athos, who tells him to go. I feel like that but is sort of a but what should I look for type of thing. Do I need to be suspicious of everybody? Like, when you say search perimeter, like, I'm new at this. I'm not a trained musketeer. I literally stumbled my way into some modicum of success over the last 3 days.
Like, all right, forget that. Back to the king and his awful outfit. He even goes, "You look beautiful." And she says, "Thank you." And she doesn't say it back because he looks, it's the worst thing I've ever seen. One, it's very close to Ramirez's outfit from Highlander,
except not as colorful.
Except it's got dumpy ass. This thing is the worst looking. It looks like you've taken a dump. It's so bad. It made me laugh.
I mean, to be fair, like when you look at like the official portraits, like they're all like, you know, it all looked like they filled their diapers. Like it's very frumpy and frou-frou. It's the same quality as the costumes I saw in the Wishbone episode.
So what I'm wondering though is, do you think he walked by Frampton Rochefort and was like, "Why can't I dress like that? Those clothes are available to me. I'm the king."
Yeah, why can't I look like Johnny Cash?
Why do I have to look like little Lord Fauntleroy? Why do I have... I've got this bob.
To be fair, they are... I mean, we're getting a child wedding, which is kind of disturbing. So he's still figuring out his fashion. He's only 14 or whatever.
Yes, they are. I think they both are 14 or 15. Yeah. In the real life.
Which is the norm. Like, if you were a royal, it's like, all right, you're going to marry your cousin when you turn 14 to secure the alliance.
And you're going to wear a lot of lace. Don't complain.
Yep, it's going to be frilly, and you're going to wear stockings, a lot of shoes with buckles.
So, yeah, and again, talking about kicking outside your coverage, she is much hotter than him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, as these things usually went, like it's shockingly, if you look back through any royal history, it's usually an upgrade for the dude. And you know, I mean, up to the current day with, you know, I mean, I guess either of the, you know, royal sons who neither are aging well, I guess. No. Who's the one who's exiled to Canada? He's doing okay in the works, I guess.
The one that married that filthy American.
Yeah, the suits lady.
I think she's Canadian.
Whatever. She's a commoner though. She's a common actress. A
commoner from the colonies. Oh no.
Whereas like you look like, you know, and then you look at like Kate Middleton, who is traditionally just like literally a Disney princess, and her husband looks like, you know, just a bridge troll again.
He's like melted wax.
He's like a combination of Zuckerberg meets like Bezos.
Yeah. Yeah. He looks like he would be a tech bro if he weren't in line to be the king.
He definitely drank some of that zippity doo dah water. It has affected him.
Dudes always level up and women are just forced to go along with it.
Yep.
So yeah, they're all getting ready for this event. He's happy she's there. They're going to work. This is a weird interchange in like, you know, he's so powerful. We've got to do something about it. We'll do it together.
While they're walking down the aisle, talking very loudly.
They're not getting married. This isn't marriage. This is his birthday.
Yeah. Wow. I thought they were getting married.
Nope. They're already married.
This is a weird birthday.
Well, don't. I won't do this for your birthday.
Why are they walking down an aisle for the birthday?
Because of the courtiers need to see them.
This is the norm. They got to let all the ugly commoners see them.
Yeah.
Is this like a coming out? Like when debutantes come out and like,
yeah, this is their quinceanera.
Everyone's getting their ears pierced.
It's the king's birthday. Let's go see the king. We'll wave at him.
Gosh. You know what that? Oh, can you imagine what it smells like in that?
Oh no!
In that I just imagine everything stank all the time because everyone's wearing like heavy woolen outfits, and it's always rooms with no windows and no breeze, no air.
This comes out late, but this is coming out much later than the show's on. The show may even be over now. Go watch Shogun. There's a scene where they're in, you know, Japan, and one of them that says, "Would you like to bathe?" He's like, "I already did this week," and looks at her like she's crazy. Like, I don't, if I bathe again, I'll get sick. And it's like,
from the Pirates of the Caribbean water.
Yeah. And the Japanese are kind of like, sure. No, but okay. Do you just want to smell like that?
So. It's like in Westerns, how like a cowboy would just sit in a big tub of water for 20 minutes and that was a bath. Yeah. And then he was good for, you know, the
rest of
ride.
The movie.
Yeah, I'm sure this smelled rank, but I'm sure everyone was just used to it. Like, you probably don't even notice anymore.
And imagine how it smells even to the French people, like the French people, the like the king, this dumpy
they
pants.
Just call them people there.
Yeah, they just call people. The people.
Listen, there's at least one thing that's clean in this entire courtyard, and that is the very tip of the sniper's gun, which is reflecting light down into the crowd.
Yeah.
Take lessons, snipers. Don't polish your weapon.
Nope.
If you know what I mean. If you know what I mean, yeah.
Yeah, they're
in a public place. Playing on polish your weapon.
The whole, like, oh, we have to see the sniper. Well, does he have a scope? Well, this is kind of... So let's just make the gun really shiny.
Yeah.
We'll do that trope.
How did D'Artagnan get in the castle?
He's never been in this palace before. How does he know which of the, I'm sure, a million staircases to take? Like, you go around one of the palatially sized museums that we have here in America, and it's very easy to get lost in those. That's why they have got maps lost everywhere.
I famously got lost in the Vatican, and I didn't have to climb any stairs. I just was walking, and I got lost.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the same way. I want to know how that was resolved. Like, did they have to,
the
like,
you know, the Da Vinci,
the Pope? I know the Pope.
You know, the Da Vinci guards.
Yeah.
One of the Swiss guards brought me out.
Well, it didn't help that you got into the Vatican by rappelling down from the wall.
He had the staff. He had the stick with him. And he walks up to me and I'm like, I'm lost. And he's like, American idiot. And he like takes me and out the thing.
Da Vinci guards.
You should have said, I'm a lost. And he would have said, oh, you're lost. I gotta be fine.
I gotta find the Pope.
It's me, Jonathan.
I was with friends, so we're all kind of like, we're all not supposed to be here. We don't know. But we didn't do it maliciously. We were just...
You're just dumb Americans.
Yeah, we're dumb Americans. And we got lost in a part where we were literally like, everyone around us is a priest. We're in the wrong place. We're literally like, we're where they were. We're like in the... It's like going into the West Wing, like accidentally, like walking into like the working part of the Vatican.
Like the Pope and a cardinal into a room and walk and talk.
Like the Pope and a bunch of cardinals are working on like some document and they stop and look at you.
They'll look up and they've got a map of the world where they're changing the sizes of the continents based on how powerful
they've
we are.
Got like that giant donkey wheel from Lost where they wield their power.
It's a bunch of gold left over from World War II, from all the victims of World War II.
They're scratching out all the Nazi symbols.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, everyone seems to know exactly where to go in those giant ass palace and complex of buildings.
This is something that's going to be, this is going to be a TC Boo at some point. By the way, at this point, please join our Patreon. We have a Patreon. It's at, I assume, patreon.com/swordboys. I'm going to put my hands up because as of right this second, I haven't actually created it yet. But I'm creating it like tomorrow. So if it isn't here, I will add something at the beginning of this episode again, speaking about it. But
I hope that that's taken and it's just some like unseemly like militia dude or something. Like,
give me money so I can overthrow the government on January 6th.
Like it's like those Bundy dudes who overtook that federal land out west. Like he for some reason has sword boys, and I was like, getting all this money from a bunch of nerds. What's going on?
But anyway, we're gonna do the
I'm
man
getting
in the
a 404
iron.
Error. So
I keep bringing up the man in the iron mask. It's not taken. The Man in the Iron Mask is the, in my mind, the spiritual sequel to this movie. And I like to think of it as just older versions of these people later on. Mm-hmm. And one of them is played by Gabriel Byrne. And I think the sniper looks exactly like Gabriel Byrne in The Man in the Iron Mask. And I just kept, every time I kept looking at him, I'm like, it's Gabriel Byrne. It's Gabriel Byrne.
He has a Gabriel Byrne vibe. I see it.
Yeah. So we're going to do Man in the Iron Mask though, just at some point. So just know that's coming.
All right.
The tease.
I love when he fights a Captain America.
Okay. What was that about?
Sorry. Remember we fixed my Zoom audio thing before the recording?
We didn't fix it to make you funny. It doesn't have a setting
It's supposed to block all the bad jokes. And now it's
turned off. Is there a slider that says funny and Robin is the other side? And can you just move it toward funny?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So, all right, here's the big fight scene.
Yeah.
Yes. Because the sniper is foiled by D'Artagnan, who slides over the top. He does a little Kilroy to start. Just pop. What are you guys doing over there? And then slides down the roof, tackles the assassin. The shot goes wide. And then.
But not that wide. Like, almost still. Like, he's tackled, but really only affects his aim by, like, I don't know, a foot. He's a good sniper. No.
It's way more than a foot because the bullet shatters the edge of the balcony.
Right,
and
but that's
a good
an angle,
like 6 or 7 feet away.
Yeah, but not at the angle he was at. At the angle he was at, it might have only been a little.
Yeah, I'm just saying, like, he seems like he's a very good sniper. Like, he's tackled and it's still not that bad.
No, like, yeah, I wish he'd hit Cardinal Richelieu, but
is he is so this the fundamentalist guy that hired? He's a gig economy guy too. So
yeah.
Like, all right, whatever.
He and that headsman know each other.
Yeah, they're in the guild together.
Yep, they're in a murderer's guild. So this is our big moment where the three come out, unleash their three. It's three on,
like 20,
40, and then out of nowhere, a bunch of guys in cloaks come out. The scene, it's not edited great. Because they all kind of come out with their cloak wrapped, like, well, we know who you are now. Like, you're all just running around with cloaks on like idiots. That would have been better if they'd all just thrown off their cloaks at the same time and jumped down and been, you know, now the Musketeers are back. Yeah. And I really thought in my mind, in my memory, this is where they say all for one and one for all. I know they say it at the end of the movie, but they don't. He says, protect the king.
Mm-hmm. It would make sense.
And he doesn't say it.
So do you guys support this insurrection?
Yes.
I mean, I guess so. Like,
it's a peaceful demonstration of a bunch of tourists that are here to tour the palace. There's no insurrection happening at this time.
Why is that one musketeer wearing a buffalo head? That is so bizarre. It's like a shaman. I don't know what's going on here.
Why is that? Is that musketeer over there stealing a podium? What's going on?
Yeah, it's like we're being forced to side either with like the French royals or the like paid mercenaries that the cardinal disposed. Like,
right.
I'm not super on board with like I don't really like either of these crews, but I guess I'll support the insurrection.
Yeah,
the insurrection, which is for the king. Right. It's like pro king.
Yeah, bunch of bootlickers.
Yeah, as opposed to, yeah, they're, oh my God, these guys are such tryhards when it comes to that. These are the kind of guys I worked for 40 years at one job.
These are the dudes who, like, were, like, too fat to be cops, but then spend the rest of their life acting like they were cops. Like, it's like, oh, I could have done that.
I think in French history, they're called boumiers. Boumiers.
Baby boumiers.
I'm a boumier. Here we go.
I think it says a lot for the brotherhood of the Musketeers that all of these reinforcements showed up and they had no clue what was going to happen. They had no details of like the king being in danger.
Oh, we were supposed to bring our
sword?
I am so sorry. Right. I just brought the shirt. I didn't. Oh.
Well, one for all means one thing. Obviously the king is in danger. Bring all your stuff.
Yeah.
I feel bad for any Musketeers that might have been like in line for the privy or like stuck in a big crowd of people that are going up to like the crepe cart because they're going for a snack and then all of a sudden everything's happening behind them and like I don't want to lose my place in line because I've been here for like half an hour waiting for a crepe.
If this movie was made now, unfortunately, there would be a fifth guy who would show up like Mr. Bean. Like, they're already fighting and he shows up in the cloak and then undoes the cloak like 5 minutes into the fight and it's all over. There would definitely be that guy.
Yeah, there's a group of lazy musketeers that didn't have the sense of urgency. They're going to show up on Saturday, the day after the king's birthday.
They're called obviously. The musketeers. They're not great.
Sorry, I'm late to the fight. He's buckling up his belt. I had to take a massive musketeer.
I just realized three this is kind of the White Christmas ending, where like all the army dudes, like, oh, I'm just going to abandon my family on Christmas Eve because we got a letter in the mail. The general needs our help.
No, because I saw it on TV. That's even worse.
That's right. That's right. Bing Crosby's on the TV telling me we're going
to
overthrow the
king.
This guy
I was in war with is on the TV. He says I got to go to Vermont.
I got to go to Vermont and kill him. Kill a cardinal.
He's telling me that we got to foil an assassination.
He says I got to be in D.C. in a specific date.
So, murders start happening. Well, okay, it's not murder. It's a melee. Like, this is a proper battle.
PG movies don't have murders. They have squabbles.
I don't know. I think Porthos murders Gabriel Byrne.
I mean,
just an old man.
Yeah. I mean, but yes, we do have a lot of murdering.
Yeah, Aramis, he kills one guard and then does the sword behind his back without looking, very Han Solo that way.
Is this our sword minute? Is this our...
Yeah.
Is this sword fight breakdown time?
I think so.
It's a sword fight breakdown.
There's a sword crime here where, like, you can't be playing with swords and then have a hidden gun.
Well, like, that's why he's like, ha-ha! Like, it's very...
Okay. The guy that he kills is just like, okay, that was not fair, but it was funny, and dies.
After Aramis kills his two guards, we see Athos. He's backed up against the fountain. He doesn't, but he still like manages to kill two guys. We see Aramis kill another, and as that guy is falling down, Aramis tells him to go with God because, you know, remember, he's the priest guy. He's the priest one. Porthos,
I gotta do my bit.
Pulls the gun out, shoots a very old cardinal guard. Like, the dude is like Santa Claus. Like, what are you doing?
Oh, man, I was supposed to retire tomorrow.
I was 2 days away from retirement. This was my last big job before I retired.
For this.
They needed the big scene where he tells the young guards, like, I'm going to go fishing every day and hang out with my grandchildren. This life is too complicated. Like, you know, the big emotional scene where it's like, oh, he's going
to
die.
Maybe I will move to Montana and get a recreational vehicle.
I'm going to get, how do you say, Jeep? A Jeep Cherokee.
Porthos shoots a guy, and then as another cardinal guard comes up to take his place, he like hits something on the gun where a little knife pops out the
gun
front.
Gun knife is so good. Gun knife is the best. Yeah.
Gun knife. And then stabs the cardinal guard in the arm so that way he can stab him with the rapier. And it's like, all right, it's hard to stay mad at Porthos.
And then he's like, I like this. Like, he never had used it. Like, he bought it. Like, someone said, it's got a knife in it. He's like, what? Okay, well, I'll try it out.
It's crazy because, like, for the entire previous trilogy, Chewie's been carrying that thing around. He's never used it.
Baby J.J. Abrams in 1993 is watching this. He's like, I'm going to put that joke in a Star Wars movie, and it's going to kill.
he went to the, what was this, 16th century? He went to, like, their equivalent of the gun shop, the sword shop. And he winked at the guy, and the guy opens up like the back room with the good stuff. Like, look, I know you're a sword guy, but this is a gun knife combo. This isn't exactly street legal. I had to saw off the serial number.
Just know that if you use this, it's not a fair duel. It's not considered a fair fight.
And if you rat me out, I swear to God.
I swear to God, I'll turn on you. Because. D'Artagnan's up there. He's fighting Gabriel Byrne, and he's stuck on one of the flags. And then,
he gets pushed off the roof, and by all accounts, he should fall. But he grabs that flag, and now that he's hanging from the flag, is a good time to pull out his sword.
Yeah.
Before then, it was all just slap fighting. and boot knifing.
I gotta say, if you can't, like, he snuck up on a guy who's laying down and still got, like, taken, overtaken. I don't know if he's musketeer material.
Okay, what would it have been to just pull out your sword and then slide, and then as you get to the bottom of the slide, just stab the guy?
Just stick it in his butt as you go down?
Just skewer him.
That'll make you miss your shot. That will make you miss your shot. From experience, if someone stabs you in the ass, you're not going to be able to. If someone spit roast you,
it screws your focus.
Yeah.
And through this entire action scene, when we're going up there, we're seeing a lot of pointy flagpoles everywhere. And I'm assuming this thing is going to end with this guy falling to his death and being impaled on one of those flagpoles. Yeah. And it never happens.
Thank goodness.
I figured out why he didn't use the sword on his butt. Sodomy's illegal at this point. Can't, can't do it.
It probably tore open his scrotum or something. Like, it probably just ripped him open.
Oh my god. So yeah, I was expecting pointy death also, and or a Wilhelm scream, and we get neither.
I know.
I mean, there is somewhat of a pointy death, because Porthos, once it's pointed out that D'Artagnan is in trouble, he opens his utility cloak and pulls out a tiny can crossbow.
I love when Kiefer, like, holds on to him like Vicky Vale.
Yeah.
How much do you weigh?
The musketeers of all the good toys.
Hey, yeah. Rick. Yeah. So not only is this a two edit thing, it's a three edit. When this guy falls and he hits, I need him to not die. Everybody needs to not die when they fall from high places in this episode. Everybody needs to be like, oh god, it hurts so badly. I'm so hurt. Guys, I'm so hurt.
Just swap in that scene from Midsummer where they have to finish off the dude who jumped off the cliff.
Is the kissing the hand and waving it is that like an Italian thing? Is that Pope?
I feel like it's a Pope. It feels popey, but
Roman Catholicism.
Porthos is a very romantic individual. So he's blowing a kiss.
This is another one of those movies where it doesn't really matter, but like the good guys have American accents. Some of the bad guys have English accents. Some have French accents. Who knows what's going on? A trend that, I mean, this was kind of true in Ridley Scott Napoleon. Like, there's just no logic to the accents.
Right. Yeah.
Which I'm not hung up on the accents, but when D'Artagnan yells, "It's about time," is very close to "fuck me, he made it" from Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves. It has that kind of, it has that energy. And then thank God, Porthos brings it back with "come D'Artagnan, we're saving the king." Like he's not in on a plan. I love it.
I have a theory that originally they had the Musketeers and D'Artagnan do French accents, but then they heard Charlie Sheen try a French accent and they're like, all right, nope. Good guys are American. Just do whatever.
And that's where this cut ends.
That is exactly.
Our penultimate episode.
That's
damn
right.
Damn good. Damn, I thought it was going to be a really slow episode. It was fucking great.
Yeah, no, there's a lot at the end.
A lot that happens.
Yeah. Next cut is definitely going to be our most action-packed cut, because the entire thing is one prolonged action scene.
Yeah. Sweet. And half of it's in the castle and some of it's down in the sex dungeon. It's going to be awesome.
And then you get the super shitty song.
Yeah. So come back, because next time, Richelieu gets caught monologuing as his plan to murder the king is interrupted by the musketeers. He flees with the king and queen into the dungeons below the palace with the musketeers hot on his heels, leaving Rochefort to deal with the upstart D'Artagnan. Richelieu almost escapes, but is foiled at the last moment when the king grows a spine. With their enemies vanquished, D'Artagnan finally realizes his life's ambition in the exciting cut 6 of The Three Musketeers.
Woohoo! That's 2 cuts per musketeer.
And 4 people per 3 musketeers.
Right.
Yeah. It's
too much math.
It is.
Don't make me do math.
There. Oh, 4 musketeers.
The Wishbone episode was titled The Mutketeer.
It's no D'Artagnan, but we'll take it.
I like D'Artagnan better, actually.
Yeah, well, so does Niall.
Talking about that.
So you have just seen this movie for the first time, Dan.
Yes.
Do you like it?
As I mean, as like an adult, time, you know, like as like a 41-year-old man, like
target demographic, of course.
Yeah, like it's a lot of it is just like trying to like copy Han Solo. Like it tries really hard with the quips and the and whatnot. Like, but like as a kid's like as like a kid's movie, like I have no beef with this movie. It, you know, it's very, yeah, like of its time. It's of that Disney era. Like, this is just like, oh, teacher's hungover. Let's bring in the cart with the TV.
We're going to learn French history. Here's Three Musketeers.
Like, why is the volume so low? Oh, shh. Like, it's that type of movie to me. So, like, I don't think I'm ever going to rewatch this. But, yeah, it's fine. I see why people who saw, I'm sure, like, I would be more fond of it if I saw it 30 years ago.
I saw it when it came out and I'm fond of it, but I don't know if it's rewatchable. It's only rewatchable if you're like really in the mood for campy, like just goofiness.
Well, part of it is like Chris O'Donnell, Charlie Sheen, not great. Kiefer's okay. I mean, Oliver Platt's great. Always great to see Tim Curry, patchy. He's fun. I will say like, if I, like this is around the time, like, when, you know, Dick Tracy was just giving me all types of weird feelings. Like, I feel like I'm like, oh.
Like sexual feelings?
Yeah. Well, do you remember, like, I mean, you remember Madonna in that movie?
I remember Madonna, yeah. I remember
her. Well, like, in that movie, like, that's another, like, another very horny Disney movie was Dick Tracy.
Well, it has the word dick in it. You should have known it was going to be
horny. Or The Rocketeer. Like, this, to me, this is like poor man's Rocketeer. Like it's going for the swashbuckling thing, but not as Stephen Herrick's no Joe Johnson.
You know, I like it still. It's still good. I don't think anybody's not liked it that's been a guest.
This it definitely picks up towards the end. Like the beginning, like I'm like, I don't care about this. What's going on? Like I'm like, just show me Tim Curry again. Let him choose some scenery.
Well, that's good. Thank you for being on, Duff. Do you have anything that you want to promote? I know you do a podcast, even though Rick, you know, dead named you into a podcast.
Dead named me. yeah.
That you're not on.
Yeah. So afreepodcast.com. You can find us. We do just random seasons of bullshit. trying to think what I think. Depending on when this come out, we might have released the Buddy Cop season. Depends on whether we get our act together. Otherwise, yeah, Titanic Minute, Forrest Gump, which has just totally been erased from my brain. That's new to me, so you can listen to it. Tell me things you learn about Forrest Gump, a movie that I actually went into with an open mind and now hate. Like I, but yeah, you can, yeah, just link to shit. I don't know. A free podcast.
And you can find us at swordboys.biz. Everything's on there, including our, as of now, probably not new Patreon, but go just sign up for Patreon there. We've got extra episodes, extras being TC Booze, There Can Be Only One. Episodes where we're like, we just can't do this in chunks. It's just, I mean, if I go back now, Hawk the Slayer should have been a TC Boo. It wasn't. Lesson learned. Now we know there are certain movies that don't require months of our work.
It's legendary status deserved closer examination.
That's
so.
What Rob. Okay, Robin says so. Okay, then we're good.
I do not regret the
but time. But movies you'll see on there like Highlander 2, probably Conan the Destroyer. You know, basically, let's say sequels to better sword movies. I have a feeling TC Booze is going to become this place of weirdness where people were like, well, we made a lot of money, what should we do in the next movie? Let's just screw it up.
Yeah.
And if you have if you have any ideas for us, let us know at our email address at swordboys.biz, all spelled out. Swordboys, right? It's spelled out. Is there dot? Is it an actual dot?
It's swordboys, like a period.
Yeah, dot.
So swordboys.biz, as if you were typing at a website, at gmail.com.
Which it's so weird they let us put dot in there. That's what I know, that's right? My problem is that I can't remember. I thought it was like DOT. It's not DOT.
No, it's not DOT.
It's actual dot. So swordboys.biz, let us know. And at a certain level on Patreon, kind of like if you're listening to a free podcast, they have a certain level, a tier that if you just pay them money, we'll just do the movie. So we'll see. If it's a Sword Boys movie that has swords in it and we want to do it, we'll definitely do it on the TC Boom.
I'll watch anything for money.
Yeah,
there you go.
That's the right attitude.
Yeah. Well, thank you for doing this. This is another free podcast that we're doing right now.
But not a free podcast. Correct. All capital letters.
It's
trademarked.
It's one of the free podcasts.
Yep.
Until 2 weeks from now, thank you very much for being part of it. We'll see you next time. Clang, clang.
Clang, clang.
Clang, clang.
Clang, clang.
All for one.
And one for all.
All for love.
Oh. Get out of here.
You and your pedantry. Stop it. Let's make it all.